Welcome, my second sem student. Today we are discussing about the genus Equisetum. You all know that Equisetum is a fern genus commonly known as horsetail, scoring grasses, oatstail, millstail, or snake's grass or puzzle grass. This plant is herbaceous and perennial plant which is under Equisetopsida, and they are mainly native in Arctic and temperate regions of northern hemisphere. But they have cosmopolitan in distribution except in New Zealand and Australia. Next, come to the systematic position of Equisetum. Equisetum is present under the kingdom Plantae, division Pteridophyta, and under the class Equisetopsida, order Equisetales, and its family is Equisetaceae, and one of the common species is Equisetum arvens. There are more or less 50 species, and 8 of which belong to the genus Equisetum sensu stricto, and 7 belong to Hippocoetidae. Equisetum is predominantly northern in distribution, while Hippocoetidae is widespread in both northern and southern hemisphere. Many of the species grow in tropical South America and West Indies. The plant body of Equisetum has an aerial part and an underground rhizomatous part. The rhizome is perennial, horizontal, branched, and mainly creeping in nature. And the aerial part is herbaceous, and usually they are annual plant. And majority of the species are small and size range between 15 and 16 centimeter in height and 2 centimeter in diameter. However, there are some variations also. Some species grow in higher heights. Example, that is Equisetum giganteum, Equisetum telmacia, Equisetum ramosissimum, that is 4 meter, they grow in 4 meter height. And though their stem are relatively thin, and they also showing vine-like habit and climb over adjacent forest trees also. There are some difference between Equisetum and Hippocoetidae. What are the difference? In case of the stem, Equisetum have aerial stem, generally branched and annual, but Hippocoetidae have also aerial stem, and generally they are unbranched and perennial in nature. In case of the stomata, in case of Equisetum, stomata are scattered in the furrows of the stem, and they are at the same level with the other epidermal cells. But in case of the Hippocoetidae, stomata are arranged in 2 longitudinal rows in the furrows of the stem, and they are sunken below the surface of the epidermis. Lips are blunt in Equisetum, and lips are pointed in case of the Hippocoetidae. And strobili born on the chlorophyllous vegetative stems or on non-chlorophyllous stem, and they are not yet pointed and lacking apiculum in the genus Equisetum, but in Hippocoeti, strobili born only on the chlorophyllous vegetative shoots, and they are pointed, that is apiculate. And in case of Equisetum, gametophytes are upright, plate-like, lamellae or on gametophyte. And in case of the Hippocoeti, gametophytes are upright, column-like, lamellae on gametophyte. And there are some example that is Equisetum arvens, Equisetum telmata. They are restricted to the genus and restricted in the genus Equisetum. And in case of the Hippocoeti, that is Equisetum hymeli, Equisetum levigatum, etc. And Equisetum mainly grow in damp habits, that is in wet habitats. They like to grow in wet habitats, and particularly common along banks of streams or irrigation canals. However, some species like Equisetum arvens are adapted to xeric conditions. Some common Indian species are Equisetum arvens, Equisetum davili, Equisetum division, Ramosisum, etc. Some species of Equisetum are indicators of mineral content of the soil in which they grow. And some species also accumulate gold, about 4.5 ounce per ton of dry weight. Thus, they are considered, these plants are rather considered as gold indicator plants. And hence, these plants help in prospection or exploration for new ore deposits. In Equisetum, silica is deposited on the outer wall of the epidermal cell, giving the characteristic rough feeling. Thus, it provides a protective covering against predators and the pathogen also. Next, come to the structure of the Equisetum. Rather sporophytic structures, because their plant body, that is the sporophytic plant body, is differentiated into three parts, mainly stem, roots and leaves. This is stem, roots and leaves. It's okay. And next come to the structures of the stem. The stem of Equisetum has two parts, the perennial, underground, subterranean, merge branch rhizome, and this is rhizome, and then erect, usually annual, aerial shoot. The branching is monopodial, and shoots are differentiated into, you see here, nodes and internodes. Okay. From each node, a whole of small scale-like leaves arise, which are connate laterally in part, forming a shape around the stem. They are much branched, slender, adventitious roots arise in holes from the nodes of the rhizome. See here. These are the adventitious roots arise from the rhizome. And branch primordia or buds arise at each node in the axil of the sheath and its very base alternating with the leaves. Some of which may give rise to either aerial or subterranean branches, which burst the sheath and become exposed. In majority of the species, all shoots are alike and they are chlorophyllous also. And some of them, only some of them, bear strobili at their apices. Example, Equisetum ramosium, example, divine. But sometimes shoot shows dimorphism. That is, they possess two types of shoots. One is vegetative, completely vegetative shoot, and another bear strawberry, that is the fertile shoot. Example, Equisetum arvens. Some shoots are profusely branched, green, chlorophyllous, and purely vegetative. The others are fertile, unbranched, brownish in color, that is our chlorophyllous branch, and have terminal strawberry. The underground rhizome and the aerial axis appear to be articulated or jointed due to the presence of distinct nodes and internodes. And externally, the internodes have longitudinal ridges and furrows, and internally they are hollow tube-like structures. The ridges of the successive internodes alternate with each other, and the lips are normally of the same number as the ridges on the stem. Clear? Next, we come to the internal structures of the stem. The stem of Equisetum shows an interesting association of xeromorphic and hydromorphic characters. That is, they possess some xerophytic characters, some hydrophytic characters with vascular systems. In TS, the stems appears wavy in outline. See here, that is wavy in outline, with ridges and furrows. The epidermal cell walls are thick and cuticularized and have a deposition of siliceous material, which is a xerophytic adaptation and which protect the plant from the water loss. And the stomata are distributed only in the furrows between the ridges. A hypodermal sclerochymatous zone is present below each ridges, which may extend up to stele in Equisetum giganteum. And cortex is differentiated into outer and inner regions. The outer cortex is chlorenchymatous, while the inner cortex is made up of thin wall parenchymatous cell. And next to chlorenchyma is a few layered inner cortex composed of thin wall parenchyma and is interspersed by a ring of longitudinal canals, which is a large air cavity like in the inner cortex, corresponding to each furrow and alternating with the ridges, which is known as valicular canal, which is one of the example of hydrophytic adaptations of Equisetum. This is valicular canal. This is large air cavity like structures, and this is varicular canal. These are schizolysogenous canals extending the entire length of the internodes and form a distinct aerating system. And new lips and branches of the Equisetum are produced by the apical meristem. However, most of the length of the stem are due to the activity of intercalary meristem located just above the nodes. See here, this is the node just above the node. And the activity of intercalary meristem causes rapid elongation of the inner nodal region. The stele is here ectofluid siphonostelic. So Equisetum have ectofluid siphonostele type stele, which is surrounded by an outer endodermal layer. And inner endodermis is also present in some species like Equisetum selvaticum. And endodermis is followed by a single layer pericycle also. The vascular bundles are arranged in a ring which lies opposite to the ridges in position and alternate with the valicular canals of the cortex. So here, vascular bundles are alternately present to the valicular canals. Okay. And vascular bundles are conjoined, collateral, and closed and inductive. In the mature vascular bundle, protoxylem is disorganized to form a carinal cavity which is opposite to the ridges. See here, these are carinal cavity which present opposite to the ridges. The metaxylem tracheids are present on the both sides of the phloem. In some species, vessels with reticulate perforations are reported. The central part of the internode of aerial shoot is occupied by a large pith cavity, which is formed due to rapid elongation of the internodal region. And xylem is here poorly developed. So this is also a hydrophytic character. They occur in three separate strands, metaxylem on the two flanks of phloem and protoxylem on the inner face in the young bundles. In mature bundles, protoxylem lie in the periphery of the carinal canal, and the water-filled carinal or the protoxylem lacunae are formed by breaking up of protoxylem during maturity. These are carinal canals. Okay? These are carinal canals. At the nodal node, a difference in the anatomical structures form that of internode in case of Equisetum. The vascular bundles are connected by xylem forming a continuous cylinder, and carinal canals are absent, and while the valicular canals are present only in Equisetum debye. Pith is here solid, forming a diaphragm separating the internodes. And the nodal vascular cylinder is siphonostyliti. The vascular bundle remain unbranched until they reach the level of node. And in the nodal region, each vascular bundle trifurcates, that is, divide in three parts. The middle branch, noted, the middle branch of the trifurcation enters into the leaf. And each lateral branch of the trifurcate bundle joins a lateral strand of an adjacent trifurcate bundle to form a vascular bundle of internode. Thus, the vascular bundles of internodes alternate with those of internodes above and below. And the nodal region, the xylem is extensively developed as a conspicuous circular ring. There are no valicular or caninal canals at this level. In addition, a plate of pith tissue occurs at the node, which separates one internode from another. The internal structures of the shoot of Equisetum is peculiar because it shows xerophytic as well as hydrophytic features. Next, come to the point, that is xerophytic adaptation shows by Equisetum. They have ridges and furrows in the stem, deposition of silica in the epidermal cells, sunken stomata are present cells, and sclerenchymata hypodiris present, reduced and scaly leaves present here, and photosynthetic tissue also present in the stem. But there are some hydrophytic characters in equisetum also. The editing system like carinal canal, vesicular canal and central pith cavity, which are the hydrophytic characters, and reduced vascular element, which also are hydrophytic characteristic features, which is present in the equisetum. Next, come to the structures of the root. Root is ephemeral, and slender adventitious root arise endogenously at the nodes of the stem. In TS, the root shows epidermis, cortex, and strelae from periphery to center. That is epidermis, cortex, and strelae from periphery to the center. The epidermis consists of elongated cells with or without hair. The cortex is extensive, that is the made up with sclerenchymatous, that is thick walled cell, and those of the inner cortex with the parenchymatous, made up with parenchymatous cell. The stele is protostele, where the xylem is striate or tetra, or in smaller roots may be dyad. A large metaxylem element is present in the center of the stele, and the protoxylem strands lie around it. The space between the protoxylem groups is filled with phloem. There is no pith at all in root. Next, the structures of the leaves. The leaves of the equisetum are very small, simple, scale-like, and isophilous. Attached at each node, that is, leaves attached at the nodal region, united at least for a part of the length, and thus form a sheath around the stem. The sheath has free and pointed teeth-like tips. Pointed teeth-like tips. And the number of the leaves per node varies according to the species. The species with narrow stems have few leaves, that is 2 to 3 leaves in case of the equisetum scirpoides, and those with thick stem have many leaves, that is equisetum scaphaneri. The number of the leaves and the nodes corresponds to the number of the ridges on the internodes below. And leaves do not perform any photosynthetic function here because the stem is photosynthetic here. Okay, and leaves do not perform any photosynthetic function in case of the equisetum, and their what is their function? What and their main function is to provide protection to young birds at the node. Next, a very important point, that is reproduction in equisetum. Equisetum reproduce vegetatively and by means of spore. And vegetative reproduction takes place by the subterranean rhizome of some species like equisetum telmacia, equisetum arvens form tubers which on separation from the parent plant germinate to produce new sporophytic plants. This is a very common feature, and tubers develop due to irregular growth to some buds at the nodes of the rhizome. And mainly reproduction takes place by spores, and spores are produced within sporangia, and sporangia are born on the sporangiophore, that is a stalk-like structures which is known as sporangiospores, which are aggregated into a compact structure stem strobilus or cone or sporangiospherous spike. In case of equisetum arvens, which is commonly known as hostel, consists of strobilus, and each strobilus has a thick axis having several holes of densely crowded pelted appendages situated on the sporangiospores. The sporangiospores are arranged in hole. Usually each hole is composed of 20 sporangiospores or so on in case of Equisetum arvens. In many cases, immediately below the sporangiospores, the central axis of the strobilus bears a small ring-like outgrowth, which is known as annulus. And each sporangiophore is composed of a single slender stalk, of which the terminal end is expanded into a flattened pelted disc situated at right angles to the stalk. The pelted disc is usually hexagonal in outline in its surface view, and this hexagonal appearance of the disc is attained due to the mutual pressure of the disc of the crowded sporangiospores situated on the strobilus. Each pelted disc bears a ring of 5 to 10 isolated sporangia on its undersides, and each sporangium is elongated and sac-like. On their maturity, the sporangia open by longitudinal slits or dispersal for the spore dispersal. How these sporangium are developed? The mode of development of the sporangium is mainly eusporangiate. As it is not entirely formed from a single initial, superficial cell adjacent to the original initial may also take part in the development of the sporangia. And sporangia are initiated in single superficial cell around the rim of the young sporangiophore. This is the structures of the sporangium and sporangiophore. The periclinal division of the sporangial initials forms an inner and an outer cell. The inner cell, by further division in various plants, give rise to sporogenous tissue. The outer cell, by periclinal and anticlinal division, give rise to irregular tiers of cells, and the inner tiers of which may transform into sporogenous tissue, and the outer tiers become the future sporangial wall cells. But not all the sporogenous cells function as spore mother cells. Many of them degenerate to form a multinucleated nourishing substances for the spore mother cells. And each spore mother cell undergoes now meiotic division, that is reductional division takes place, and produce spore tetras. All spores in a sporangium are of same size and shape, that is they are homosporous. The innermost layer of the sporangial wall differentiates as an tapetum. The sporogenous cells separate from each other, round off, and eventually transforms into spore mother cell. All but the two outermost wall is disorganized to form a periplasmodial fluid. Now, come to the point, that is structure of the mature sporangium. Mature sporangium is an elongated sac-like structure attached to the inner side of the pelted disc of the sporangiophore, which is the pelted disc of the sporangiophore, and it is surrounded by a jacket layer which composed of the two-layer cell, and the inner layer is generally compressed, and the cells of the outer layer have helical thickenings which are involved in sporangial dehiscence. So, okay, this is dehiscence. At the time of dehiscence, the slit-like structures present here. And the sporangium contents within it, the mature spore are alike, and that is the Equisetum is homosporous, teidophyte. And sporangia are attached on the underside of the hexagonal plate. This is underside, attached with the underside of the hexagonal plate. And hexagonal plate-like, that is pelted disc-like ring, and each sporangiophore bears 5 to 10 sporangia. And how sporangial dehiscence occur at maturity? The strobilar axis elongated. As a result, the sporangiophores become separated and exposed, and then the sporangium splits open by a longitudinal line due to the differential hygroscopic response of the wall cell. See here, this is at the time of dehiscence. There is a slit-like structures occur due to the hygroscopic response of the wall cell. Next, the structures of the spores of Equisetum. And spores are spherical and filled with densely packed sclerophores. See here, greenish structure. And spore wall is laminated and shows four concentric layers. The innermost is very delicate in time, followed by thick exine and middle cuticular layer, and the outermost epispores or sperispore. The intine, that is endospore, and exine are the true walls of spores. The outer wall layer, that is cuticular layer, and epispores are derived due to the disintegration of non-functional spore mother cells and tapetal cells. And at maturity, the epispores, that is the outermost layer, splits to produce four ribbon-like bands or strips with flat spoon-like tips. Okay, this is a very special structures of Equisetum spores. These bands are free from spore wall except for a common point of attachment and remain tightly coiled around the spore wall until the sporangium is fully matured. And these are called elaters. The elaters are hygroscopic in nature, and the spores remain moist at early stages of development. Thus, the elaters are spirally coiled round and spore, and the spores dry out at maturity, and consequently, the elaters become uncoiled. And these uncoiled elaters become elongated with the elaters of other spores. And through this action, the elater help in the dehiscence process and also the dispersal of the spore in large group of spore from the sporangium. And elaters of Equisetum are different from those of the elaters of the bryophyte. It's okay. Next, come to the gametophytic structure. Equisetum, we all know that Equisetum is a homospora stereophyte. And the haploid spores germinate to form gametophyte. The germination takes place immediately if spore land on a suitable substratum. If the spore do not germinate immediately, their viability decreases significantly. The spores swell up by absorbing water and shed their exine. And first division of the spore result in two unequal cells, that is one large cell and one small cell. The smaller one elongates and forms the first rhizoids. And larger cell divides irregularly to produce the prothallus. The prevailing environmental conditions determine the size and shape of the prothallus. If a large number of the spores are developed together within a limited space, then the prothalli formed are of thin filamentous type. But a relatively thick and cushioned separate prothalli are also formed here. From where? From sparsely germinating spores. And mature gametophytic plants may range in size from a few millimeters up to 3 centimeters in case of the Equisetum debile in diameters. And they are dorsiventral and consist of basal non-chlorophyllous cushion-like portion, from which a number of the erect chlorophyllous multicellular lobes develop upward. The unicellular rhizoids are formed from basal cells of cushion. The prothallus bears sex organ and reproduce by means of sexual method. Next, come to the point, it is sexuality in Equisetum. The gametophytic plant body bears sex organ, that is antherodium. That is, male sex organ is known as antherodium and female sex organ is known as archegonium. We all know it. And the gametophyte are basically homothallic, that is, they bear both male and female sex organ, that is, they are bisexuals. Although some dioecious members, that is, unisexual members, are also reported. Some are initially unisexual and then become bisexuals also. Equisetum is homosporous and therefore definite sex determining mechanism is totally absent here. But the sexuality demonstrated by some of the members appear to be related to the environmental factors. Therefore, it is termed as environmental sex determinations. Antherodium in Equisetum, that is in Monotia species, develop later than Archegonia. There are two types, projecting types and embedded types. That we get both types, projecting and embedded types of Antherodia. And Antherodia first appear on the lobes of the gametophyte. And the peritoneal division of the superficial antherodial initials give rise to jacket initials and an androgonial cells. The jacket initials divides anticlinally to form a single layer jacket. The separate divisions of androgonial cells form numerous cells which on metamorphosis produce spermatids or antherozoids. The antherozoids escape through a pore created by separation of the apical jacket cells. The apical part of the antherozoids is spirally coiled, whereas the lower part is some extent expanded, and each antherozoid has about 120 flagella attached to the anterior end. And in case of the Archegonium, any superficial cell in the marginal meristem act as an Archegonian initial, and these Archegonian initials undergoes peritoneal division to form a primary cover cell and an inner central cell. So, after peritoneal division, we get two types of cell, primary cover cell and inner central cell. The cover cell by two vertical divisions at right angle to each other forms a neck, and when central cell divides transversely to form a primary neck canal cells and a ventral cell. Two neck canal cells are produced from the primary neck canal cells, while the ventral cells by a transverse divisions forms the ventral canal cells and an egg. At maturity, an Archegonium has a projecting neck comprising of 3 to 4 types of neck cells arranged in 4 rows. Two neck canal cells of unequal size are ventral canal cells and an egg at the base of embedded ventral. The Archegonia are confined to cushion region in between the aerial lobe. Fertilization is here, that is water dependent fertilization process, and the gametophyte must be covered with a thin layer of water in which the motile antherozoids swim to the Archegonia. The neck canal cells and ventral canal cells of the Archegonia disintegrate to form a passage of the entry of the antherozoids. And many antherozoids pass, noted here, many antherozoids pass through the canal of the Archegonia, but only one of them fuses with the egg. This dip, thus a zygote is formed, and generally more than one Archegonia are fertilized in a prothallus. An embryo, that is the mother cell of the next sporophytic generation, and unlike any other pteridophytes, several sporophytes develop on the same prothallus. First division of the zygote is transverse. This results is an upper epibasal cell and lower hypobasal cell. There is two type of cell, that is upper epibasal, lower hypobasal. And embryo is therefore exosporic, that means where the apical cell is divacted outward, that is towards the neck of the Archegonia in polarity. No suspensor is formed in equisetum, and the epibasal and hypobasal cell then divide at right angles to the ugonial wall. And as a result of four cell quadrant stage is established. And all the four cells of the quadrant are different size and shape here. The four-celled embryo undergoes subsequent divisions, and the future shoot apex originate from the largest cell and leaf initials from the remaining cell of one quadrant of the epibasal hemispheres. One of the epibasal quadrant and a portion of the adjacent quadrant of the hypobasal region contribute to the development of root. And first root develops from the one of the epibasal quadrants and the portion of the adjacent hypobasal quadrant also. Later, the root grows directly downward and penetrate the gametophytic tissue to reach the soil or substratum. A number of such sporophytes may develop from a large mature gametophyte if more than one egg is fertilized. Okay? And the last point is life cycle of the equisetum. That is, we get here gametophytic and sporophytes, that is haploid gametophytic generation and diploid sporophytic generations. That is the plant body of the, that is sporophytic plant body of equisetum. And from where we get, that is the strobilus, which from where we get the spores. And these are the elaters and spores, fusion takes place, and then the gametophyte, next the gametophyte development is occurred, where we get the male sex organ, that is antherodium, and female sex organ, that is oogonium. And after that we get the antherodium and archegonium, that is we get the, after the germinations of the spores, we get gametophytic generation, that is the prothallus, and where we get the antherodium and archegonium. And after the formation of the zygote, we get the new sporophytic plant when the environment is favorable. Okay, that is the young sporophyte on gametophyte is developed here. See here, young sporophyte is developed on the gametophyte. Okay, this is the root which is grow downward, and this is the upward, upright, upward portions. Okay, that's all. This is the life cycle pattern of equisetum.